with desperate times call for desperate measures. So I'm gonna go from this to this. Yes, so this is where I'm gonna be training for the next several weeks, maybe months, who knows with the situation that we're in. But I know a lot of you guys have been sending me questions about equipment when it comes to your garage or home gym setup. Now I have a good amount of experience in this field. However, I wanted to bring on a guest who knows way more about this topic than I, has hundreds of videos on his channel, and is just a standout dude when it comes to creating content. So without further ado, I'm gonna send it over to Brandon Campbell Diamond, AKA Basementbrandon, who's going to share with you some things to consider when it comes to buying equipment for your home or garage gym setup. Take it away, Brandon.
Hey, what's up, everybody? My name is Brandon, and Joey asked me to come on the channel to talk a little about building out a home gym. And it's really timely that this video is happening because previously, many of you might have been considering or thinking about a home gym. And now with the current events going on, you're basically forced into one until your gyms reopen, which who knows when will be. So I just kind of want to kind of share some insights, some things to think about. I don't want to come on here and just tell you what to buy and what brands are the best, just because I find a lot of that is dictated by personal preference, your own budget, your space constraints, whatever the case may be. But that being said, I do have over 1,100 videos on my channel, most of which are geared towards equipment reviews and my own training at home for the past 5 years. I do compete in powerlifting when I'm not working my corporate America gig, and my best lifts to date have been a 600-pound squat, a 350-pound bench, and a 655-pound deadlift. I only say that not because those are necessarily good numbers. Just take a look at what Joey's doing. They're much better than mine. But because some people base validity of what you say on how much you lift. So kind of right in the middle there. So what I say is kind of in line with probably what you're thinking. And last but not least, let's be honest. This is the internet, my friends. And if you say it on the internet and make a video, that makes you a guru and an expert. So I guess there's always that. But that being said, there's three things I think you should focus on when considering a home gym. That's going to be price or budget, also usability, and lastly, footprint. Now, how much weight you put into each one of these, no pun intended, is really going to vary, again, based off your own personal preferences, your own budget, and your own space at your home. So if you're living in a one-bedroom apartment in the city, your probably biggest concern is space constraints. If you have a ton of money and an unlimited budget, which would be really sweet, probably don't care how much money you spend on some of this. You just want the best overall equipment. So again, these things are going to vary for everyone. That being said, based off of my conversations, usually the initial kind of roadblock to people going with the home gym route is the cost. They take a look at the equipment that they'd want and the build out, and they see that it's going to cost them several thousand dollars. And they say, I'm going to have to go to the gym for 20, 25, 30 years in order to break even. And depending on which gym you go to, paying as little as like $10 a month from Planet Fitness or $100 to $200 a month for some of these private barbell clubs and CrossFit boxes, that number is really going to vary. But I don't think that's a good way to look at initial cost. Instead, I like to take a look at what's my most valuable asset, and that is my free time. So for me, the convenience of being able to come and train at home with a wife and two young boys, I want to cut down on all the fluff time as possible. So the way I like to train, which is usually geared towards strength and powerlifting, I'd have to drive about 30 minutes each way in order to get to a gym that I would find suitable. So that ends up being an hour a day, 4 to 5 times per week, over the course of a couple months, over a couple years. We're talking about a large chunk of time, and I would much rather put that time into training at home and freeing up that time to either train more, get more work done, or spend time with my family, which is, again, the most important aspect of my life. So there's different things you can look at, but for me, you can't put a price on convenience. Not to mention that a lot of this gym equipment, depending on what you buy, actually it retains its value really well. So it's more of an investment. And I say this from firsthand experience. We recently sold our home and we're currently building our new one. So we're in a rental right now. As part of that, I completely sold my old gym setup, 6-post rack, reverse hyper, fancy bikes, everything for under the sun. I had a couple of racks in my old setup. And I sold all of that and still was able to make about 70 to 80% back of what I paid and invested in a new gym, which better fit the space I'm in now, which is a single car garage versus my big open basement before. So this is really an investment. So even though initially the cost may seem high, if you ever choose that you don't want it anymore, you can still get a good amount of your money back. Now, that being said, if you take a look at going to the gym, yes, you're paying for the access to all those different pieces of equipment and it's probably cheaper month to month, but you're not getting any of that money back. You're probably just throwing it away. So depending on how you look at it, you can get pretty creative with that. And a home gym doesn't have to be expensive. Yes, it can be very expensive depending on your needs, your preferences, your wants, your desires, but you can be really smart about your purchases and make sure you can keep it all within just a couple of $100. An easy way to do this is just buying secondhand, which a lot of people are big fans of. However, I will say, given the current time frame where everyone's looking to buy stuff for their home gym, the market's probably going to be dried up a little bit more. The prices are probably going to be a little bit more elevated. And if you're the type of person like me who wants specific equipment or want to train on certain things, you're going to end up having to wait for those to come up, because chances are, if it's a good piece of equipment at a good price, it's going to go extremely quick. So you have to be pretty diligent about building out your home gym and being patient in that regard. Now, a lot of that also, to me, comes down to usability, which is the next thing I want to talk about, meaning that, are you actually going to use the equipment? So a lot of people just buy stuff like a basic rack or a basic barbell because it's cheap, it's affordable, but chances are it's not very good. In fact, they'll usually compare it to their gym experience, saying that, I just really can't get the same work in and at home that I could at a gym. And thus they're not very apt to use their home gym. Or they buy a piece of equipment like a treadmill, and after a couple uses, they just decide, or they realize, that I don't like doing cardio. And instead, this is going to become a glorified clothes rack. So it's all about buying stuff that you know you're going to use and caters to your style of training. So in my instance, I don't mind paying a little bit more for certain name brands or certain pieces of equipment like milled plates or calibrated plates, because those are what I want to train with. And it's super awesome to be able to come to my own home gym and basically have every piece of equipment that I would want or need that motivates me to train more, versus coming to a space that has equipment that I probably don't really find that useful, or is low quality, or the gym has better stuff. I'm going to want to go to the gym instead. So the usability is a huge factor. Now, speaking about some of these things as I go through them, they do play a role in counterbalancing each other. For example, when we're talking about budget again, you could probably go and get a cheap rack on Amazon for like $200. The problem is the usability, in my opinion, is going to be very low, because if you take a look at the specifications, the weight capacity of that rack might be like 300 pounds, which for most of us will easily exceed with a year or two of training, and you're thus going to likely want to upgrade that rack or pay for another rack on top of it, in which case it would have been cheaper just to get a better rack up front. Now, some of the stuff you have to look at here is, even though the weight rating might be like 500 or 1,000 pounds, and you might not necessarily ever lift that much. If you do, good job, kudos to you. But it's a testament to the quality of material that you're buying and how close you get to that max threshold. So again, cheap, yes, good for budget, not good for usability, because chances are it's going to break or you're going to want to upgrade. So there's that trade-off there. On the same hand, just because something is more expensive doesn't mean it's better. So you could get a $1,000 Aliko powerlifting bar, which is a great bar, but if you only have a $1,000 budget, it's probably not a good idea to get it. Instead, you can get one of the power bars from Texas Power Bars, Rogue Ohio Power Bar, Rep Fitness Power Bar. There's a lot of other power bars out there that are much more easy on your wallet. So it's all about making smart choices and kind of trading this for that. And again, depending on your own scenario, that might dictate certain choices. That being said, a lot of the usability also comes into the footprint, meaning that if you can get a piece of equipment that's very versatile and allows you to do a lot of different exercises on it or use it for more than just one purpose, you can save footprint. So if you have a very small space where you can't fit a lot of separate pieces of equipment, you might want to pay a little bit more money for a nicer rack that has a large ecosystem of attachments, or get something like a kind of like a hybrid barbell that doesn't have overly aggressive knurling. That way, not only can you like squat, bench, and deadlift with it, but if you're doing things like cleans or you want to use it for more CrossFit style workouts, you can do that and not necessarily chew up the front of your neck with the aggressive knurling in a front rack position. So you really need to take into consideration all of these things. Speaking of footprint, obviously how much space you actually have is going to dictate a lot of this equipment purchasing too. So if you're the type, again, that has a single bedroom apartment in the city, probably you're going to want like a squat stand and not a six post rack. Or if you have a very large open area, you might want to invest in a six post rack, because that'll also open up a lot of the usability features. And there's a lot more that you can do with that space. Big thing to consider also is not just the actual floor space it takes up, but how much vertical space it takes up too. So if you're training in a basement that doesn't have very high ceilings, your choices are going to be limited based off what you can get. You might have to get a shorty style rack, or might even get a squat stand, or even like a combo style rack in order to make do of that. You also have to really consider your training style and preferences, as I mentioned before, because again, if you're not buying stuff that you would typically use in the gym or for how you train, you're not going to use it. Thus, it's going to render it pretty useless and you waste your budget, footprint, And again, the usability is very low. So you really need to take in consideration all three of these things. I'll give you another real good example before I stop kind of hammering on here, is let's take a look at adjustable dumbbells. So for me, I usually recommend Iron Master dumbbells to people. I have a 5 to 120 pound set, and it all it takes up is roughly like 4 square feet. So it's like 2 by 2 worth of space. And I could use a dumbbell anywhere from 5 pounds to 120 pounds. They also have another add-on that bumps up to like 160 pounds. And the initial price for just the 5 to 75 pound set is like $700. And a lot of people are going to say that's really expensive. And it is, but not when you take a look at it in context. Because if I were to get separate individual dumbbells from 5 to 75, I'm probably going to spend $2,000 to $3,000 on doing that. So the budget's going to be a lot more, but also the footprint that those dumbbells are going to need are a lot more than, again, just a quick adjustable set. On the flip side of that, if we want to go on the lower end side, you could get the tried and true spin lock dumbbells, which are much cheaper. You could probably get a set for like $100 or $200 and add on weight plates or buy weight plates as you see fit. The problem with the spin lock, although they're budget friendly, is the usability feature isn't very good. So budget friendly, footprint friendly, usability, in my opinion, is very low because not a lot of people want to take the time to unscrew each end of those dumbbells and screw them back on in between weight sets. It's a very timely process, and I already talked about how time is probably my greatest asset. So it's going to take a lot of time to do that. So much so, in fact, where I find a lot of people just don't want to use them because they're a pain in the ass to adjust. Not to mention the spin lock style. If you're doing any pressing movements where you typically would set the dumbbells on your knees, depending on the size of plates you're using, they're going to dig into your quads. And for some people, they hurt to the point where, again, they just don't want to end up using it. So again, when you're making these decisions, take into consideration the price, the usability, and the footprint. And I think if you weigh all three factors based off what's most important to you, you'll find that you get the best bang for your buck and the most usability for how you train, all while fitting in the space available to you at home. And hopefully you'll find that a home gym is a great gym to have, especially in these trying times like today. So that's what I have to say. If you have more questions on this, I'll be sure to be in the comment sections responding as needed, or you can head over to my channel and check out any of my reviews and ask me opinions on any piece of equipment. Even if I haven't reviewed it yet, I'm more than happy to help you give some feedback. But in the meantime, thanks for watching, and thanks for Joey for having me, and stay big.
So thank you so much, Brandon, for giving us that information. I know it's going to be very valuable to a lot of you during these times, and just giving you guys some things to consider when putting together your home or garage gym. Make sure you head over to his channel and subscribe. He has a ton of videos out there that I'm constantly watching and using as a reference to help me make my decisions. So I only have people on the channel that I really like, enjoy, and agree with. So make sure you go subscribe, tell them Big Joe sent you, and go dive into all the videos that he has over there. Once again, thank you so much, Brandon, and hopefully I will be able to train in your basement one time. But until then, guys, stay lean, mean, train machine. I'll catch you next time. Peace.